So please join me in welcoming John Stephenson.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay? All right. Again, my name is John Stephenson. I work for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. What I want to do today is kind of give you an update on wolf recovery in Oregon, where we are today, how we got here, and where things are headed in the future. I wanted to say from the start that wolf recovery in Oregon is very much a combined effort with the state and the federal agencies, and wolf recovery kind of started as a federal effort, and now is for many years now has been shifting over to a state-by-state run effort. And the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife has really stepped up and done a great job here in the state. Most of the photographs of the wolves that you'll see today were taken by them. So, see if I can work this. So I'll start out by just describing the difference between coyotes, which we have had lots of here for many, many years, and the wolf, which is now reappearing on the scene. Coyotes are about a 20 to 30 pound animal. Wolves are about a 70 to more like 110 pound animal, much taller, very leggy. Let's see if I can. If you are, we get lots of wolf sightings reported to us, and one thing, if you do think you see a wolf somewhere, it's a couple things to keep in mind and look for. It's a little tough to see on this diagram, but wolves have much shorter, more rounded ears, a big blockier head. Coyotes have kind of a long, tapered nose, big, their ears are much larger in proportion to their body. The wolves have extremely large feet. Their tracks are about 4 inches wide by 5 inches long. Coyotes have quite a bit smaller paw prints. In fact, forgot to mention on the first slide. So I can't go back. Or hit previous would be a thing. Okay, no going back. Huh? Which one? Okay, no going back. Can you actually put it back though, and then I won't do it again? Yeah. All right, just wanted to show you that's a good example of the prints on the left are wolf tracks, the prints on the right are coyote tracks. It's a pretty big difference. All right. Oh, I know what it is. I gotta point it there.
Or you can just raise your hand and I'll go forward.
All right, I guess next slide. So I'll just start with the current state of affairs and then go back in time and tell you how we got here. This is the situation today in Oregon with the distribution of wolves. Pretty much all of the pack activity is in this northeast corner of the state in Wallawa and Umatilla counties. I'll talk in depth about these later, but there's now 4 known packs, 3 of which have had pups. And then we've had these dispersers, as I'm sure you've heard about OR7, our most famous wolf, and I'll talk a lot about him later. So how did we get here? Go back to the mid-1970s is when the federal level, the Northern Rocky Mountains Wolf Recovery Program was initiated. In 1980, a recovery plan for bringing wolves back was published. At that time, in the early 1980s, the only place wolves were known in the West was just in the very northwest corner of Montana, and just one or two, or just a handful of individuals, not even a pack. They did a huge analysis of where recovery would be most likely be successful for wolves. The 3 areas were the northwest Montana, where they already were and kind of associated with Glacier National Park, Yellowstone National Park and the greater Yellowstone ecosystem, and central Idaho was identified as a recovery area. So this area had wolves. These 2 areas did not at the time. So in 1990, as I said, the recovery plan came out in 1980, but it took until 1994 before this full environmental impact statement for reintroducing wolves to this area and this area was completed. It was extremely controversial. It was on this environmental impact statement, the Fish and Wildlife Service got more public comment on this than any other EIS that they ever did. So, and as you can see, even going back to the beginning, there was a lot of controversy surrounding it. So after that EIS was released, they had to go ahead to reintroduce wolves into central Idaho and Yellowstone. Started in January of 1995. They released 15 into central Idaho and 14 into Yellowstone National Park. These wolves were captured from up here in Alberta. The ones in 95 were from Alberta, and the ones in 96 were from British Columbia. Basically about as close to this area as you could, as there still were wolves to go get. This is, I'm sure those of you who follow the wolf issue has heard about a lot of controversy now about we reintroduced the wrong wolf, and these are Canadian gray wolves. But it's really not a fair criticism. You have to go to where the wolves still are to get something to reintroduce, and they went to the closest place they could find. In Yellowstone, they did what was called a soft release, where they had family groups of wolves. They pinned them in the areas for 4 months before they released them, just to kind of habituate them to the area. That was very successful. In central Idaho, they did what's called a hard release, where they basically just brought them in, kicked them out of the cage, and let them go. That also was very successful. So. Wolves are actually pretty hardy and pretty successful creatures. So, they did the second release in 96. So 35 wolves were released to central Idaho and 31 to Yellowstone National Park. And another thing that's often said is there's a lot of conspiracy theories that we've reintroduced into Oregon or other places. We have not. The state has not. The only reintroduction that was done in the Northwest was these releases here in central Idaho and Yellowstone. Everything since then has just been an expansion of that population. Just wanted to point out why central Idaho was considered such a good spot for reintroduction, and kind of feeds back in to later in my talk when I describe some of the problems we do have with wolf management. The green is wilderness. The purple is roadless areas. This is central Idaho. This is this Frank Church River of No Return wilderness, just an enormous, by far the largest wilderness in the lower 48 states. Very remote, very few livestock, very rugged, few people. It was a great spot to put wolves. You just do contrast that with what we have in eastern Oregon. It doesn't show the west. We have a little bit more large open spaces on this Cascades, but we don't have anything near that remote livestock-less country that they did in central Idaho. So the population started growing immediately, did very well. By 1999, you see about 13 packs in Idaho, 6 in Montana, and 11 in Yellowstone. They took off, the analysis that was done in terms of where to put them, I think, was right on. There was plenty of prey, and they did very well, prospered. In 1999, so just 4 years after the first reintroductions, a wolf shows up in Oregon. B45 was what it's called. These names for the wolves are based on the radio collars. This was the 45th wolf that was radio collared in Idaho. So, and they introduced 35 to start with, so this was probably the first offspring born in Idaho from the reintroduced population. It's a 2-year-old female, kept heading west into the John Day Basin, caught Oregon very much by surprise. This is very similar to what California is going through now with this OR7 that's appeared in California just in the last couple months.